welcome back to Fitzfest Talks, presented by Mila, the final and hopefully the funnest session of today, our matinee performance. Hope you enjoyed your pinch off and all the lovely food and drink provided by the Bass Culinary Centre, for which we are very grateful. So a reminder before we get going, we're only about an hour late, so don't worry about that. Before we get going, that after the talks ends, there will be buses outside. Some of the buses are returning to Bilbao, for those that want to head back that way. Others, provided by Wiggeritz, are taking guests to Wiggeritz's 20th anniversary party. So make sure you get on the right bus. They will be marked, but just ask if you don't need diversions or mishaps. Okay, I'm also going to remind you that tomorrow morning there's a press conference at the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, followed by an event called Food Meets Art, presented by Sanford Green. And on Tuesday evening, there's a small matter of the World's 50 Best Restaurants Awards at Palacio Euskalduna in Bilbao, and we're very much hoping to see you all there. Okay, our final guest is here to provide us with a very sweet ending to our 50 Best Talks, a moment or two of indulgence after lunch. She is one of the judges on US MasterChef, but most importantly, the founder of the highly successful and influential Milk Bar concept in the US. A pastry chef with an unashamed sweet tooth, she's also been the subject of Netflix's recent Chef's Table pastry series. So please welcome to the stage, Christina Tosi. Some of our 50 Best events in the past, as a guest and supporter of your husband, Mr. Will Dara, who's here with us, but let's face it, you're actually way more successful and far more famous than he is. Just to let everybody know the format of the next hour or so, here's how it's going to work. We're going to show on the big screen here a few sections from the relatively recently launched Chef's Table Pastry series featuring a certain chef. In between those bits, which are courtesy of our friends at Netflix and Boardwalk Pictures, we'll have a chat about your career as a pastry chef, starting Milk Bar, being a woman in this industry, the health debate, crack pie, whatever else takes our fancy. Plus, we've got three Mila ovens lined up here, and we're not afraid to use them. So, for those of you that haven't had the benefit of visiting Mill Bar and sampling one of Christina's famous cookies, we're going to do some baking on stage, and you're going to get a little taste of something a little later on. Okay, so to kick things off, we're going to sit back and watch the very beginning of the episode of Chef's Table, including the credits, as I think this section showcases part of what's great about you, and part of what's great about the Chef's Table series as a format. So, let's watch. Tell us about the experience of Chef's Table, how they approached you, and what made you want to do it.
Well, they approached me, David Gelb and the team at Chef's Table approached me about a year ago this time, actually, and just like a cold email, hey, we're doing a four-part pastry series. Four different pastry chefs, one from each country, and we want you to be the American pastry chef. And having watched the series and loving the storytelling from so many great chefs that are in the crowd and across the world, my first reaction was, my story is not the typical story of like this gorgeous pursuit of this culinary passion through the lens of typically fine dining. My world is full of 140 quart mixers and thousands of sheet trays and rolling racks, and it's like a Willy Wonka factory of cookies and cakes and pies, but that's so different than the story that they tell through these gorgeous images through past chefs' tables. And they kind of came back to me and said, no, we know exactly what we're getting, and we want to do it. We think your story is really compelling. And I then just felt this great sense of duty as an American pastry chef, as a very, 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 like, middle America, grew up eating and learning how to bake from my grandma's oatmeal cookies rolled in confectioner's sugar and sheet pancakes and the most humble American baked goods, that is so deeply who I am as a person and who I am as a pastry chef. I then felt an incredible sense of duty to want to share my story in the best light possible, to shed a light on, for me, what American dessert is and stands for.
Christina, going back to the chef's table approaching you to do this, does the fact that they were looking at pastry, is that really important for you? Because do you feel that pastry is sometimes undervalued as in our wider kind of gastronomic world? Was that part of your motivation you wanted to represent?
Yeah, that's a great question. I try not to bear the chip on my shoulder as a pastry chef that pastry is undervalued or perhaps under-celebrated, because that would argue that what savory chefs do is overvalued, and I don't think that's actually the case at all. I just think pastry needs more of a place to showcase the artistry behind it. I also think the world of food is changing, where you're seeing more pastry chefs taking more of a center stage and doing more dynamic, individualistic things rather than just serving the last course of a great dinner or lunch. And so I thought, for me, I was very proud to be a part of it, and to even know that the chef's table team was looking at dessert and looking at the people behind great dessert or trying to move dessert forward through their own lens, me included, and to showcase them. And like, what better place to start doing it than by these incredible storytellers?
You're also on MasterChef, and we're not just going to talk about your TV career, but you're also on MasterChef, and has that changed perception of baking in the US, or yeah, are you seeing more kids interested in baking, do you think?
I think the most incredible part of joining the MasterChef team has been really understanding and witnessing firsthand what an insane revolution the younger generation is having in developing their relationship with food and wanting to get involved and being curious about it, in wanting a hands-on experience and wanting to hone in on the craft of cooking and baking. For me, coming on as a judge, as a baker and as a pastry chef, was also important to me to show, well, one, I'm the only female judge, to show that there can be a woman of authority, which was uncomfortable for a lot of people to start, a lot of viewers. But also to show the kids that you can be whatever you want to be. You don't have to be a guy in a suit that has 12 restaurants. That's an incredible feat, but it can look a bunch of different ways, and it can come across as very formal or very serious, or in my case, oftentimes very friendly and very approachable. And that the spirit of food has really, really, really wide guardrails.
And how do you see the situation in the US with regard to kids and their understanding of nutrition and baking, and you know, there's a whole raft of debates you can have about that, but do you see any positive movement in US society in that respect?
It's so hard, that's a double-edged sword, because I think I see a lot of positive movement, but then I also see the reality that's happening on the other end of the spectrum, which is that there's still a great deal of challenge with processed foods and foods that are really high in sugar and preservatives and things, and that food coming at a very, very, very low cost. And that within America, at least, not everyone has the choice to be really interested in food and have access to that type of food to explore. There's still a great deal of America that only has access to the food that they have access to, which is like $3 a day and 3,000 calories of, like, you know, bags of chips and, processed meats and sugary drinks and so on. So there's still a very large divide, but I think the more we can put the spirit of food out there from a craftsmanship standpoint and
from an enjoying it standpoint, from an understanding where fresh food comes from and how to prepare it and how to have fun with it so that vegetables aren't boring. I was raised as a kid, vegetables were boring. You tried to get away from them as much as possible. The more that we can create that intrigue and put it out there in a way that's accessible on the internet or on national TV, I think the more we can move the needle with it. But again, it's a really loaded question because it comes all the way down to legislation and how.
And I guess brings us on to the kind of health and nutrition debate. How do you marry the fact that some of your creations have lots of sugar in,
yeah,
and not necessarily conventionally healthy? How do you marry that with, you know, responsibility to society as a whole, not to give them, you know, not, we have a lot of sugar, there's an obesity crisis,
yeah,
in the US as well as lots of parts of the world.
I think about the spirit of what I do at Milk Bar as being baking but also being beyond baking. It's the spirit of making this dense, sugary, gooey, indulgent slice of pie that we call crack pie. But it's not about, it's about the spirit that gives you, this transformation that it brings to your day, the joy that it brings to your life, and the way it sort of fuels your happiness and your soul and your spirit. And we're using great ingredients that go in, but we're also not proponents of go out and buy this pie and eat it every single day. It's we want to be the celebratory moment of the big and little things in life. And life is about balance. The expectation of only eating really healthy, I think, is underestimated because depending on who you are and what's important to you, for me, I can eat healthy if I know that I have a moment to celebrate being good by being a little naughty and indulging. And I think that spirit, that sort of like sneaking a little nibble, being a little naughty, is an important balance in life. And that's what we stand for.
So what, just reeling back a little bit, and I know this is covered in the show, but we can't see all of it. What drew you to baking and this profession in the first place?
I was raised by these really strong and mighty women that were always in the kitchen. They baked every meal. There was always dessert. And food was for sustenance for the family. But food was also the connection of our family to the communities that we were a part of. So I was raised by grandmas and aunts and a mom that was a working mom. I'm the youngest of two, and so I was kind of just raised by my grandmas when my mom was working, which basically meant if they're in the kitchen cooking or baking, that was just like childcare. And I watched these women take care of people that were having bad days or people that were sick or people that were in need or people that were having good days by cooking and baking for them and then feeding them. And I don't think I realized until much later in life how powerful that was. The kitchen became this place of like safety and security and acceptance. Because like growing up as a kid, you go through all of the like fun phases of childhood, the awkward phases of teenagedom, and the kitchen was always the place that I was accepted and welcomed. It was the place that I could sort of tinker without any sort of judgment, and I could sneak a little nibble of cookie dough. But then the result of time in the kitchen, watching these people be affected by how we chose to spend our time in the kitchen and then bring it out to their homes or hospitals or communities, for me, just felt like the most fulfilling thing in the world. And it wasn't until I had graduated college and was about to be a grown-up that I realized, like, I don't want to wear a suit and go to work every day and sit at a desk and feel like I was changed to an occupation. And so I asked myself the very simple question of, all right, well then what is it that you could do every day without getting sick of it? If you don't want the routine of going to work and sick every day, what could it be? And I just dug deep to those very simple moments of growing up in kitchens with homemakers, not at all professional chefs, no professional bakers, just like home cooking, casseroles and cornbread and roast chicken, like simple, honest food.
And when you moved to New York, which we'll watch in a minute, but why did you definitely go into the pastry and not become a commis chef in the non-pastry section? Or did you work your way around sections?
I moved to New York to go to culinary school to become a pastry chef because I love, I have a very sweet tooth. I love cooking, you know, as you heard. But this, the spirit of the vehicle of this like round baked piece of dough, this cookie, like the power and the magic of this cookie was something that I never, ever, ever got away from. Nothing ever piqued my interest or my curiosity more than baking, the craft of baking, and then baking for others. So as I moved to New York and went to culinary school, I worked in kitchens, and I worked on the savory side because it was, I worked a bunch of different jobs. I worked in the dining room, and it was important to be well-rounded, but I always went, it was always just to explore and then drove me right back into the pastry side of things. There's something about dessert. It makes everyone happy.
So, okay, before we talk a little bit further, we're going to explore a little bit about your early career working as a pastry cook in New York and how that shaped your outlook. So here is Christina arriving from Virginia, I believe.
Ohio and Virginia.
Virginia via Ohio or something all the way around.
Arriving in New York. I dog-eared all of the restaurants that had any sort of reputation. I just needed a job and I wanted it to be in a restaurant. I knew once I got my.
So a little insight into, you know, the, if you like, the tough kind of upbringing in the industry that you had. How do you recall that period, and you know, was it, if you like to use a cliche, the making of you working in those basement kitchens for all that period?
For sure. I was raised by two really passionate individuals who were really passionate about their, what I would say, boring professions, but you've never met like a more passionate accountant, and you've never met a more passionate agricultural economist. And so they raised me to know that what I should do for a living is to find the thing that I'm passionate about and to do it. It just looked different to them. But they raised me through their own behavior. They raised me because their families, their parents, their upbringing was really hardworking farmers and military people, like farmers in a military family. And so I knew what I wanted to do. I knew that my parents would not understand, like, why you work so hard for your next generation to make it further than you. And the concept of telling them that I was going to take the life that had been handed to me and move to New York City to start at the bottom, literally at the bottom, in the basements of these restaurants in New York City, I knew that if I was going to do it, I better mean it. And so I did it. I moved to New York City, and if you watch the whole episode, I think you get also a deeper sense of I'm super competitive. I'm very intense about the things that I care a lot about. And there was just one thing to do, and it was to go and do it. And it didn't matter what it looked like or what it took. It was just to get it done. And I did not know that going into it, that was the best and only mindset that would guarantee me success. But I went to culinary school, and while I was going to culinary school, no one's hiring anyone in New York City with like a resume. It's like, I worked at this little place in Virginia. That does not register for people. And so I had to get my foot in the door in a few places. The first was at Boulay, and yeah, I mean, I have memories of I was the only woman in that kitchen, which was great because I knew I stood out. And even though sometimes that would be stand out in a bad way, it was like I knew I stood out, and my point was to stand out. But they don't like order clothes for a young lady, right? Like they order chef whites for big burly line cooks. So I remember going in and like having like 36 waist chef pants and having to remember to get like the saran wrap from the pastry station, and that would be like my belt that I'd have to tie in. And that was just like the start of the uphill battle of working from 6 o'clock in the morning until 2 o'clock in the morning, 6 days a week so that you could get your seventh day off. And I was just so blissfully happy in the pursuit of it. I didn't move to New York City to make friends. I moved to New York City to become the best pastry chef that I could be. And it came with a decade of soldiering for other people in the most like trying and grit intense moments possible. And I have the most beautiful memories of it because when things come easy in life, you don't appreciate any bit of it. It's the work that you put in that gets you to where you are, that you look back and can say, like, I did that, I remember it, I mean it. And life was stripped down to, like, the essentials of any cook, which is, like, getting enough sleep to stay alive the next day, family meal, and then trying to work faster and harder than everyone else in pursuit of rising.
And what was the culture of kitchens like at that time? And how do you, I mean, on a kind of serious note, is the stuff that's changed that had to change, do you see change in kitchen culture, whether it be, you know, sexism or harassment? I don't know if you experienced that, but yeah, what was the culture in kitchens in general? I'm not being specific.
Yeah. Well, the culture in kitchens back then was different just because the ratio of men to women was different. And so you're in a kitchen with a bunch of dudes, and they don't know what to make of this woman in the kitchen, or two or three women in the kitchen. And so I think also, whether you're any young cook, man or woman starting out, you're going to get taunted, you're going to get picked on, right? Like, you have to prove to everyone else in your brigade that you deserve to be a warm body on the line. Like, if you're not adding to the team, you're sinking the team on the line. And so it was an uphill battle. I would do things like, I started wearing this bow on my head because I was like, all right, well, you are making me really uncomfortable, and so I need to find something that's going to make you uncomfortable. I'm going to wear an obnoxious, colorful bow on my head because I'm here and I'm not going anywhere. And I think it's just having the grit of knowing that, of course, on your way up, people are going to try and take you down, not in a purposefully hateful way, just because that's what it's, when you're dealing in a competitive field, that's what it's like. But throughout the different kitchens that I worked in, I learned not only different techniques, but I learned a lot about different kitchen cultures. I think Wiley's kitchen at WD-50 was the best example of such a positive, productive kitchen culture. He loved having a woman in the kitchen because he was like, it's great. All the dudes, like, they wear deodorant, they shave before they come to work, they're a little more put together because there's a woman in the mix. And he treated every single one of his cooks with respect and regard. And my favorite chefs were the ones I worked for that stripped you down to the cook that you were and the chef that you wanted to become, and it wasn't about man or woman. And so by the time I opened Milk Bar, I knew exactly what kind of kitchen I wanted to build and what kind of team I wanted to have. And it was a team of passionate individuals that were driven, that weren't afraid to make mistakes, but that had that internal drive in them and that wanted to take care of people.
Just going back to Wiley, who's obviously one of the big influences on your career. How did he influence you? He's a great thinker about food. What did he teach you?
I learned everything about hustle and speed and technique and ordering and all of the, like, operational parts of being a great cook for everyone else I worked for before Wiley. For Wiley, I learned how to think about foods. And not only did I learn how to think about food, because he would give you food, whether it was your first day in the kitchen, he would literally come to introduce himself and give you an amuse that was going to go on the menu that night and say, here, eat it, which your first day, you're working for Wiley, you frame, you're like, oh, I think he hasn't even mistaken it for someone else or what have you. And he feeds you food and he says, what do you think about it? And he demands that you have an opinion. And I had never worked for a chef that asked my opinion about anything.
And you can't just go, oh yeah, that's really nice.
And if you said that's really nice, like, I think it's good, chef, you would say, well, what's good about it? What do you like about it? If you had to change one thing, what would it be? Do you get the texture? He wouldn't give you his opinion. He would require that you had more to back up. This is delicious. This is the most delicious. How is it the most delicious? He would challenge the way you assessed food, and it changed everything for me. It changed the way I thought about eating out. It changed the way I picked apart, like, a grilled cheese sandwich at home. It made me really think about what's good, what's better, what's happening here. Like, why are these flavors melding? Why are they not? What about textures? And that, for me, was where I started to really take off and separate from the pack, if you will, because all of a sudden, it wasn't just about muscle memory and working smart and working hard. It was about actually thinking about the flavors and the food and the whys. The why all of these other things that I had learned about technique up until that point. Why and how the smallest little thing would make the biggest difference in the dish that we were serving.
So we're going to do a little break. We're going to put some cookies in the meal oven.
Okay, but you got to get in the kitchen. She made a birthday cake for every birthday and for every occasion. And the birthday cake she would always make for me, because she was a working mom and did not have the time, was a funfetti cake, which is basically a box cake that you add like 2 eggs, a cup of oil, a cup of water, whisk, oven, and then this shelf-stable tub of frosting with rainbow sprinkles in it. And I always thought it was, growing up, once I had started working for a while, I was like, that is such a trashy thing. Like, would kind of shy away from it, and then when opening Milk Bar, I realized that it wasn't just a nostalgic attachment that I had to those flavors, but that it appealed to so many others. So this is a sort of sandy, fudgy in the center, crispy on the outside cookie that celebrates that funfetti or confetti rainbow sprinkle layered cake of my childhood birthday.
I'm going to switch back to what we were talking about earlier, then we're going to watch another clip, but at the end of your time at, towards the end of your time working with Wiley, you kind of fell out of love with the fine dining world. If I'm not mistaken, tell me about that. And you say in the episode that you had this opportunity to potentially be the pastry chef, and you were like, actually, I'm not sure I want to do that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the confetti cookie story is probably a great intersection as well, because for a decade I had been working so hard to fine-tune my palate in fine dining restaurants, because that is where the most competitive cooks went to play and went to hone their craft. And I realized, as I had made my way up at WB50, that I loved the chase, I loved the pursuit of rising, but that if I wasn't careful, I would be making these gorgeous, elegant desserts, but serving them to maybe 100 people a night, maybe 150. And in my heart, I just kept going back to the draw of a cookie, the draw of how I was raised in these like childhood moments of bringing someone a batch of brownies and the simple, nurturing act of something that is incredibly democratic and that feels homespun in a way that somehow conveys a deep spirit of love in my mind. And I was worried that I was going to become what I would call a really fancy pastry chef, which I would have been so proud to do. But when I kind of looked down at myself, I knew deep down that my spirit was much, much, much more casual, that my voice through food, as Wiley helped me fine-tune it, was much, much, much more casual. And I knew I needed to get out of WD-50, and I knew I needed to figure it out, because You can't be the most passionate person about something if you're not actually doing the thing that makes you the most passionate. And it was make cookies.
And you, through a kind of roundabout route, ended up with Dave Chang at Momofuku, and you, I would say, married the casual nature of your creations with a kind of high-end restaurant. So we're going to take a little look at the creation of one of your signature dishes, hopefully. This is before milk bar with even an inkling. Mm-hmm. And him pushing you, because he says that he needs to push you out.
Yeah. I met Dave through working with Wiley, because as you know, the restaurant community is large but infamously small. And Dave knew that I had pastry experience.
There you go, Mike.
Oh, they're better. Dave knew that I had pastry experience. Momofuku did not have any dessert on the menu at the time, or it had like a store-bought dessert that they would just put on the plate and be like, get out. But I was so drawn to Dave. I was drawn to Dave because he had a really interestingly similar path in the culinary world in New York City. Moved from Virginia to go to culinary school. He had worked for great, great, great chefs. He had soldiered for them. And he got out of it because some part of it didn't make sense. All he wanted to do was serve delicious food to people in this very, very, very casual way. And beyond that, he didn't even want the guardrails of a given cuisine. He just wanted to cook loud, delicious food his way, when he wanted, with whatever ingredients he wanted, inspired by whatever he wanted, and he did it unapologetically. And I loved his like zest, but I loved his vision. I loved his, this is the food that I want to make, and you can either come and eat it, or you don't have to come at all. And it was Momofuku at the time in 2007. It was magnetic. It was electric. It was what we had all secretly wanted in New York, but couldn't quite put our finger on. And I just knew I needed and wanted to be a part of it. We get along like siblings, for good and for bad. And I think he realized really quickly, as I helped him build the Momofuku empire, that I really needed my own thing, and that I needed to be my own boss. And so he kind of set up these different challenges for me along the way. He'd sort of push me into the kitchen to make dessert, even though I was like, I don't want to make dessert. I don't know what I want to do. I don't want to make dessert. I just want to help make Momofuku great. And it basically led to being like pushed out of the house in all the ways that I needed to be pushed out to blaze my own trail and start my own thing, which was Milk Bar 10 years ago this November.
Thank you.
I know.
Tell us about that first Milk Bar, how it happened and why.
So the first Milk Bar was on just in from the corner of 13th Street and 2nd Avenue in the East Village, right next to Sambar. And it was specifically there through, you know, happenstance, which is typically, I think, how most great stories start. One of our neighbors was leaving, and we were worried from a Sambar standpoint that someone new would come into town. It's easier to know your neighbor. I was making desserts for the Momofuku restaurant sort of in late at night after everyone had gone home. And Dave was like, why don't you just take the space? I know that you love cookies. I know that you want to do something different. Just go and just do it. And so I took the space, and in a matter of months with very little money, built this quirky American-style bakery. No business plan. I knew what I wanted to make in my head, but even on the eve of opening the doors, realized that I didn't have a menu, and so I took the top off of an extra stainless steel table and wrote the menu on like dry erase and hung it. And worked morning till night making these crazy layer cakes that weren't frosted on the sides, because that's what I thought great cake should be, and it's what I believe great cake is. And these quirky flavored cookies, and this crack pie, and cereal milk, soft serve ice cream, this whole fleet of soft serve ice cream machines, and it was kind of like just my little wonderland. It was what I thought New York City needed in terms of a bakery, and it was everything, every single part of who I am through dessert on the menu.
And thankfully, lots of customers agreed with you.
Well, I don't know what happened, but we opened the doors November 15th, 2008. I kind of opened the doors at 7 a.m. and looked out, and there was a line, and I couldn't figure out why. I mean, it's not, you didn't know what Milk Bar was. Oh my God, saved by the bell. All right. Are you all ready for some cookies?
Yeah.
All right, sir. Don't burn yourself. That's the number one no-no. Yeah, they're done. So they're fudgy in the center, which is super important, and then a little caramelized and crispy on the outside. Oh, can you guys smell this?
Yeah.
Oh. So these confetti cookies, the secret to them also is clear vanilla extract, as opposed to the dark Tahitian vanilla extract. They sort of have the vanilla of a creamsicle, which is much more light and dreamy, if you will, with some birthday crumbs for texture folded in, and then some rainbow sprinkles as well, because sprinkles, they just, resistance is futile.
So what you're all getting is a version of the confetti cookie, as Christina said, by the Bass Culinary Center here. That is today, so we hope you enjoy a little afternoon treat. We're going to let these ones cool.
Yeah, and then we're going in.
And then anyone who wants a fresh one.
Yeah, don't be shy if you need a second.
Not now, the soft serve, please.
So, soft. Are you heating up the soft serve machine?
Yeah. What I'd like to do is show while you're enjoying your cookie the creation of one of Christina's famous desserts,
the cereal milk
kind of
coffee. Oh, yeah.
So if the guys from here, you can rerun that section of the film, that's the time you do it.
One moment. Thank you.
A little bit to the beginning of making
one day
the cereal milk
panacotta. How we would build a Monopoly empire. We had decided to open a tasting menu in a restaurant, and so we were building it out. Oh. It's a highly anticipated.
We're going to jump forward a little bit, hopefully, to actually seeing this incredible dessert. And let's go back. We're going to see cereal milk panacotta hopefully in a minute, but if not, tell us about crack by quick.
So crack pie is a marriage of this delicacy of St. Louis called gooey butter cake.
We finally got to see this famous cereal milk panacotta. It took a nation.
That's right.
Going back to crack pie, tell us about crack pie because in many ways it made you famous.
So crack pie is this marriage of inspiration between this sort of St. Louis Missouri style sheet cake called gooey butter cake and this pie that they make down south called chess pie, which is the pie you make down south when you don't have enough pecans to make pecan pie or apples to make apple pie, you make just pie. Or chess pie if you have a southern drawl and you can't quite understand. And a lot of the things that I make at Milk Bar are things that are traditionally American as a form, but that I could never quite fall in love with myself. So I love pie in theory, but I felt like pie needed to be challenged. And so I thought to myself, like, all right, well, what would make a great pie? And crack pie has this toasted oat crust. It's very savory. It's not sweet at all. It's oaty. It's party. And it holds this very dense, very creamy, very unapologetically buttery, sweet, rich filling. and we serve it by the sliver, basically. And it's all of the like best naughty, sweet, buttery things that you can't quite say no to. You can't quite stop eating, but that is like just enough to bring you the joy you need in a day. And I opened Milk Bar 10 years ago, right this day, and I had never once stopped to think, like, are people going to get this? Are people going to get what crack pie is? Are people going to get what cereal milk is? I mean, it's obvious, but at the same time, it didn't exist in the world. It didn't exist in dessert. People didn't not frost the sides of a cake and so on. And crack pie was my best example of, like, I stood there on opening day, exhausted, just baking and baking and baking, and watching these people come in droves for crack pie, and I just had a moment where I was like, they get it. Like, the world is full of these sort of sweet-toothed soulmates of mine, and they get it.
And tell us how good it's named. It doesn't actually have crack in it, I believe.
No, there's no question. I know, I'm sorry if that's a letdown to anyone else. I actually started making it when I was a pastry cook at WD-50 because I'd come in before my normal shift started and I would just bake something for the staff because every other part of the day was so precise. I would just bake. And I baked this pie one day for family meal and it didn't quite fit and gooey and buttery and intentional but also a bit of a mistake. And all of my like bro page, all of my bro cooks were eating family meal, and I can kind of hear these murmurings happening from the kitchen where we put the tableau of food and this crack pie, and this pie out for dessert. And the guys kept like taking slices and pushing it back, and be like, "Take this away from me! No, give me more!" And this amazing cook who now has his own restaurant in Sydney. This Aussie was like, "What have you done?" He's like, "It's like crack. You made crack pie," and it became this thing that if you worked in or stopped at WD-50, you knew what crack pie was. And so when I was opening Milk Bar, I had this collection of moments and recipes and things that were mine, and crack pie had been
invented. I'm going to open up to questions from the audience in a moment, but I'm going to start off with one of our questions through our social media channels, which is latest innovations in food and food technology. What do you find most interesting? Are you always aware of what's happening technology and food innovation wise, and how do you apply that to your world?
I am probably, you can ask Will, my husband, like obnoxiously interested in all of the things from like mass production to the sort of most refined technique. I think I'm the most intrigued by cricket flour. I'm the most intrigued by this concept of, as a baker, by this concept of taking something like a cricket and translating it into a flour-like consistency to be used in multiple techniques and in multiple dishes, and the benefits that it could bring. That for me makes me so insanely passionate and curious about what the baking industry specifically will look like next year, 5 years, 10 years from now.
Are you playing around with it?
Yeah, I've made compost cookies with the cricket flour before. It's really interesting. But that sort of stuff, I think, gives me hope for endless inspiration for the years that come.
Any questions from the audience? Wave your hand for Christina. We'll try and run the microphone to you. Trying to keep you alive with all sorts of crazy stuff.
I actually have a few questions that came in from social media. You're very popular, lots of great questions. And lots of just, "You're awesome, can I meet you?" But this one is from ChiraD17, wants to know what the next dessert trend is going to be.
I think trend is a tricky word to use because I think dessert is at its best when, I think food is at its best when everyone is doing what they're most curious about, when everyone is innovating on their own terms. I hope that there's no more dessert trends. I hope that there's more diversity than just trending over a certain flavor or a certain technique. I hope we just start to see more, I guess, diversity in what dessert looks like out there. And I think more than anything, I hope that there continues to be more dessert that intrigues you and brings you joy and gives you a reason to want to indulge, not just like take a picture and throw it in the trash. Because dessert is meant to be eaten and shared.
You are very, very good at being exactly yourself, but of course it's like 10 years and even more years in the making. So I'm curious, at what point did your mom and dad finally realize that your profession, which seems so much less utterly practical, was in fact like you were going to be okay? And also, was there a point where you thought, gosh, like, have this tremendous self-doubt, and what am I even doing?
Those are good questions. My mom just retired as an accountant, so I think she still worries because she's a mom, and that's what she's built to do. We just launched our 401k like retirement plan program for the entire team at Milk Bar last week, and I think that was like a big step for her to be like, okay, it's gonna be okay. You're planning for your future. I think when, even though they certainly did not raise me to care about the visibility factor or being noticed and cared and judged, I guess, for good or for bad, I think once Milk Bar opened and we, like, Anderson Cooper went on Regis and Kelly and started talking about crack pie, or I think one of her friends saw me on Martha Stewart and was like, I saw your daughter on Martha Stewart baking cookies, that she could at least understand that I was on my way. And I think a lot of the reasons that I choose to be as visible as I do now is because I know how important it was for me as a pastry cook, and even those early day moments of Milk Bar, how important it was for me to be able to show my parents who I worked for or what I had built, because parents aren't allowed in the kitchen of a restaurant. Like, the most they can do is dine. They can't see you hone and perfect your craft, and they can't see how the world receives you. So I think once that became a little bit more visible, they could understand that. And I think one of my favorite things is watching how much that inspires my team, just from a level of, I'm a part of that. I helped make that cake, or that was an idea of mine that helped this build this creation. That was a big thing.
Moments of self-doubt.
In a funny way, early on, I had no time to even understand what I was doing because it was so crazy and insane. I think 10 years in a funny way, the more you build, the more you have, the more you realize you also have to lose. And so I think it's natural to be more heady about it later than in the moment. The food world was also so different 10 years ago. Eater was a thing in New York, but it wasn't at your fingertips the way that it is now. And I am really thankful for that, because I think the more you can busy yourself with being productive and being creative and inspiring, self-doubt is like basically pointless, right? It's the annoying voice in your head that you just have to quiet. But in a funny way, I have to hush that voice now than I ever even knew that voice existed early on, because I was so busy just going out and going after it.
Final question from anyone? One more through magic social media.
One more from Instagram. At TangonJai wants to know, what advice do you have for young chefs who are working in the kitchen and facing a bad culture? For example, kitchen politics, which intends to demoralize them.
We ain't gonna positive note. We've been positive.
I think every kitchen culture is different. I can really only speak to my own experiences. I'm a really big fan of like being the change. I think being real is important as well when you're a young cook and you're on your way up. The reality is, you're working for someone to get the experience. So you can't come in on too high of a horse. You're gonna get taken down. A kitchen is a very fast-paced, very honest environment, sometimes maybe more honest than you even realize as a young cook, because you haven't quite learned to see everything and understand everything. So I think you have to give a wide lane for that. You have to develop a really thick skin. You're there for you, if you're really there at all. And so you just have to remember to keep your head down and keep pushing and be the change. If you want to see change in that culture, be the change, bodyguard, stand up for yourself, but also be honest. When you're gonna make mistakes, you're gonna screw things up, and people aren't gonna think you're worth anything until you're actually worth probably 10 times more than you are. It's a beautiful chase, but it's a tricky one as well.
Can we have a cookie?
Yeah! Okay, if anyone wants one of these cookies, join Will and I up front.
Absolutely, but can we just say a massive thank you to you. Thank you to all our speakers today. Thank you for being here. That concludes 50 Best Talks. Let's vote for that. Please enjoy the next 3 days of 50 Best in the Basque Country. Thank you very much.